Magical girls are one of the trademarks of anime. Even those with little knowledge of the medium will probably know about them just because of shows like Sailor Moon or Cardcaptors. But not all magical girl shows are just light and fun shows. There are a number of them that go into much darker territory, and these have gained a lot of popularity in the last few years, and one of the newest entries, and one of my personal favorites, is Magical Girl Raising Project. Because of the dark twist that this anime holds, it's really hard to talk about it without any spoilers, so if you want to go into it blind, you should probably not be watching a review of it. I will try to keep things as vague as possible, just keep this warning in mind, because, well, the fact that it is a dark show is kind of a twist, and again, they do reveal it with that first scene. So yeah, that's your warning. I'll leave if you don't want any spoilers. The story starts off with our main character, Kyoki, playing a smartphone game where she is a magical girl and battles evil. Ever since she was young, she loved them, but despite most of her friends growing out of magical girls, she hasn't. In fact, there are rumors going around that playing the game allows people who play to transform into magical girls in real life, and well, that's something she wants to do. As you would probably guess, she becomes a magical girl, and she saves people and helps people and all throughout her city. Well, that description is not a complete lie, just mostly. It's soon announced by Fav, who is the magical companion creature thing, that there are too many magical girls in the city, so 8 of them must be eliminated. And this is done at the end of the week. Whoever has collected the least amount of magical candies is no longer a magical girl. And the way people earn these candies is by doing good deeds and helping others. So you might be thinking that this will be a peaceful event where they will just all go around and helping others and do as much good as they can. If so, then you really are a naive person, because it is not a requirement for magical girls to be good people, or even girls, but I'll let you see that one for yourself. Some of the magical girls do try to continue to do good deeds, but many of them turn to more violent options to make sure that they do not drop out. This is one of the things I like about the show, is how it paces it. It doesn't just suddenly throw in a lot of violence, but instead it's slower. I remember seeing some comments on Crunchyroll asking where all the violence was after like episode 3 or 4, and well, I'm pretty sure they no longer have this complaint by the end with some of the battles in the last few episodes. And the battles were really one of the big highlights of the show. The stakes of the battles are always high because of the lack of the plot armor the characters had. No characters safe from having terrible things happen to them at a moment's notice. It's not like the fights are just like your classic anime fights where you have two characters fighting in an open field and it's a fair fight and everything. Instead, here you have characters using a lot of underhanded tactics, laying traps, ambushing their foes when they're weak, using mind control, and many other techniques to try to keep the upper hand. And this just makes the battle very chaotic and interesting. The power system here also lends itself well to the battles. The characters aren't all that powerful, they tend to have like the standard super strength and agility you get with the characters like these, but they also all have one specific power that makes them stand out. For example, Ruler has a power to control others, La Pucelle can have her sword become giant, and the battles are often about figuring out how to best use these powers and how to counter the opponent's weaknesses. Because the strongest powers often have some sort of weakness, or the other way around, where when you would think a power is really weak, it ends up coming to save the day in a way you would not expect. The fights make you keep wondering how the character could get out of their situation and what trick they might have up their sleeve, or if this is really the end of them because, well, you might be surprised by some of these. The battles are not super flashy, but the story they help weave makes them more thrilling than they would be on their own. The story also has some really interesting parts with the whole world thing and the mystery being revealed about why these characters having to fight the way they are, even if it isn't completely answered by the end. And yeah, this is one of those anime that certainly could use a sequel to explore more about the world or the future of the characters that did survive, though I do not feel it really needs it considering the major conflict here is wrapped up and along with the stories of these characters. Granted, that's because a lot of the characters end up not making it through it, so by definition, their stories are over. But still, for the characters that did survive, I felt that their stories were complete and they went through the character arc that the show wanted to tell, so that was good. I also like that the ending wasn't some cop-out to all the tragedy that occurred so far. The dead characters stayed dead, the pain of the event still remained for the characters who survived, but there's still a sort of hopeful message for the future, and I really like that. And speaking of characters, there are a lot of them. There are 16 magical girls, and this is a 12-episode anime, so it's a bit crowded of a cast. But despite that, I liked and cared about pretty much all the characters. Well, there are a couple characters I didn't really like, but that was more because I wanted to see violent things happen and for them to die, so I think that's a plus too. We got enough time with each of the characters to understand who they were and what they fought for, even if it was often like right before their death. Still, they felt real and I'd like being able to understand the mindset they all had with these battles, some wanting to do what was right and help others, while others just wanted to survive. I also like that the characters were of a variety of ages. You have the main character, Snow White, a middle school girl, Tama is a kid, and Calamity Mary is an adult who has her own family, so that's good just to have the variety here, instead of this just being a show with teenagers with superpowers. This also creates a lot of really interesting dynamics between all the characters, and then this really helps explain a lot of their mindsets and how they interact with each other. I don't have time to talk about all the characters in detail, but there are three of them that stood out and I think have something interesting that they bring to the show. Starting off, of course, with Snow White, or Kyuki, I think her name is. If not, I'm going to edit out the fact that I said that. She is the type of character you'd expect to be a protagonist of a show like this. She has a very ideal picture of the world and how magical girls should behave. So when she becomes one, she wants to help people and doesn't care about any of the fame that she could get from them. Of course, in a show like this, her ideals are crushed. Magical girls, though she's admired, are now killing each other, and one of the most powerful moments of the show is when she runs away from her only ally, saying that there aren't any true magical girls in the city anymore. Which, that was just really powerful and showed how far she'd gone from her dream. It did feel like she was in the background for a lot of the show, despite being the main character, but I still like the journey she went on, and even if she wasn't actively involved in all of it, she's still impacted by the events that did happen. Then you have Ruler, who was introduced early on as one of the antagonists of the show, being a leader to several other of the magical girls, and she is just perfect for her role here. What really stands out to me about her is how her whole mindset is formed. In her ordinary life, she is a very arrogant person, thinking that everyone else is beneath her, all because of her superior intellect, and she also hates being humiliated by those who have power over her. So, as a magical girl, she rules all her subordinates, judges them for their failings, and also devises a plan so she will be at the top. But she's not completely cold-hearted, and this is what really makes her interesting, is she does care about those beneath her, and I think it's really fascinating to see how she has an impact on their lives. Then at the complete opposite of the spectrum is Sister Nana, a very kind magical girl who believes in the ideals of working together and is devastated that her fellow magical girls are being killed and hurt all around her. She is ever trusting, wanting to see the best in people, and you could say she is like too idealized of a character, but I don't think that's true because by some miracle, I have met people like this before. Sister Nana is sort of a beacon of hope to other characters who are looking for someone to believe in, someone who thinks that they can all get through this. But as I mentioned with Snow White, her ideals are quite crushed throughout the show, and she is forced to figure out what she'll do and how she'll move on from this. And the reason I wanted to bring up is the contrast they have between Snow White and Sister Nana, because I think it's just really interesting. Again, I don't want to say too much, because they both go through so much, but they choose a different course of action in the end, and again, two sides of it, and I just love this. And while I did briefly mention this with Ruler, I also like the impact the various characters have on each other, oftentimes without knowing it until much later. The actions of Nemarine and Snow White being the specific instance I remember when a simple action early on had a big impact later on, and those are just wonderful. Another reason I like this show so much is how it explores the mindsets people have with the internet, or more accurately, a life online. The fact that these characters become magical girls through a smartphone app is often overlooked as nothing more than a plot device, but I think there's something interesting here. All the characters started playing the game for different reasons, all having some sort of reason they wanted something more from their life that would draw them to the game. For some, it was a place where they could feel powerful, others where they could live the dreams that would be impossible in reality, while others wanted to just escape from their difficult lives, or others just wanted to bring some excitement to a boring, ordinary life. This isn't unlike we play games or even watch anime. And the way these characters live out these new lives separate from who they are in their ordinary life is just really interesting. And it shows how we can be different in real life as we are online. And maybe this is just pretentious overthinking, but I still think it's an interesting aspect that might be good to explore in more detail in a video where I can't spoil everything. Moving on to the animation sound, and well, there's not much I can say. You see it on screen, I'm hopefully showing you a couple of cool battles so you can see what it's like, and yeah, it's okay, good I guess. Yeah, not much to say. Same with the music, though I did like some of the background music, though I can't really comment too much on that because it's really hard to find online, so yeah, I forgot to actually torrent it and download it before I recorded this. The one notable song, though, is the ending, which is just one of my favorite endings in anime because of how powerful and emotional the song is, and just really does a great way of like ending an episode with a song about all the despair the characters are going through, but also a desire to find hope through that, and well, I always love the contrast between hope and despair, and yeah, this show has a lot of that. Overall, I do like this anime a lot, as you can probably tell from all the praise I'm giving it. There are not really any major downsides here, and I recently rewatched this with my siblings, and I think I liked it even more the second time. It is true that some of the characters aren't all that well fleshed out, though, and even the ones that were explored, it felt like they could have had more done with them. It's like they hit what they needed to like check that box of good storytelling, but nothing more. The show had a lot of moments that really were trying to be super emotional, and while they did have some power to them, I think it would be better if we truly got to know the characters and got to care about them, instead of just being, yeah, I understand you. Maybe the show could have had a few more episodes to show like some more slice of life moments, or it's the characters interacting not when they're trying to kill each other, or just things like that. The plot was also somewhat predictable at times, especially when you'd have like these death flags going up and you know, okay, now it's this character's turn to die. It would be hard to do this without giving some foreshadowing, especially if they want to get all the development and the explanation. And I am glad they did this one instead of just having the characters always magically survive whatever battle they're in. And there were also a couple of things at the ending which seemed to go like too perfectly for the heroes, but given all they'd gone through, I guess I can't fault them too much for having a bit of good luck at the end. So, in conclusion, this really is a great show, so I give Magical Girl Raising Project a score of a 7.75 out of 10 and a rating of worth watching. It's a good action suspense show filled with cute girl suffering, and well, that's the type of show I enjoy. Again, there might be something a little bit wrong with me, but still, I had fun. For similar anime, the best comparison would probably be the Fate series with a whole similar death game type thing. Plot-wise, Fate Zero Escape is more similar with the strategy and the tactics involved, though some of the themes are more like Unlimited Blade Works with trying to overcome despair and all that, so yeah, go watch Fate, I think you'll like it, at least I do. If you want another magical girl show that is more normal, you could go with Flip Flappers. Well, then again, that's not exactly what I call normal, but it does have more of the lighthearted adventure, at least at times, before it completely goes off the deep end in the best way possible. Yeah, go watch that one too. Anyway, that concludes my review, thank you for watching, and I will see you all next time.